Pickett's Lock Sports Centre in Edmonton, North London, seething with anticipation, despite the doubt and controversy, for phase three of Barry McGuigan's comeback. He's already been a world champion and retired. A win, and he's on to become our first boxer ever to capture two world titles. His opponent, Julio Miranda, has never fought outside Argentina, though his record of only one defeat in 34 pro fights demands respect. But Barry's passionate supporters are praying that Miranda heads the same way as his last two transatlantic opponents.
Oh, he's got to be hitting with a straight punch there. Crowd on their feet, but Perez isn't. And Nathan really bellowing in his ear. He's got to let him box on. But for how long now in the fourth? It's all over, bar the shouting, I think. Taken his stick as much as he can, and I think that's it. He now knows I can't cope with this guy's punching ability.
McGuigan really looking for that big finisher. He'd like this one to have the sort of finality of a gunfight, wouldn't he? That's the way back, to show the Americans that I'm ready. And the game right above us, and he really is showing the distress signals now in the fourth round, and yes, it's all over there. It was inevitable finish.
Good evening and welcome to the supercharged arena that could launch Barry McGuigan back onto the world stage. With his fight coming up live in just a couple of minutes from now, watching it with us, a man who knows all about going for world titles, Alan Minter. Good evening to you, Alan.
Good morning, Nick. Nice to see you.
Certainly buzzing a bit here.
The atmosphere is electric, it's alive.
Absolutely.
But it always is with McGuigan fights.
Well, there's something about him, isn't there?
Yeah.
Just how does he compare now with the old Barry McGuigan, do you think?
I would say he's as good, he's still ambitious, he's a threat to any world champion around, and I think he will be the next world champion.
Alan, thanks very much for the time being. With the weigh-in today, McGuigan scaled 9'5". That's just right on the limit for that weight. Just half a pound heavier than Miranda. Now, McGuigan's return to the ring started in April, but this fight against the Argentine champion is easily the most important so far.
He's going to be dangerous, but I want to win, and I want to win more than I ever wanted to win before, because this is going to be the last one before I fight for the world title. And I've got to get over this last hurdle, and I will get over.
Barry McGuigan has a big name in boxing. Barry McGuigan is a big champ. We hope win the fight because have a very good condition.
I certainly have trained very hard. I'm in tremendous shape, and there's going to be fireworks, believe you me.
Welcome back to Pickett's Lock in North London as we await the entrance of Julio Miranda and Britain's most popular boxer of all time, Barry McGuigan. It's really buzzing here at the ringside. Our commentators Jim Watt and Reg Gutteridge.
And hello to you, and throw up your ringside seat with us. We've finally found a venue for this. I had a bit of problem during the week, but there you are. It's all settled now. This is where Dennis Andrews, in fact, won the light heavyweight championship of the world at Pickett's Lock. Well, a bit of a left hook from Tottenham Hotspur football ground. I'll give you an idea of where it is. First in the ring then will be the Argentinian. There he is, Julio Miranda. First time that he's fought outside of Argentine. And the man there in the blue jacket is one of the best promoters in the business and manager, Tito Lectori. And he's handled a succession of really good fighters. Carlos Monzon, Santos Lacia, Juan Roldan. He doesn't handle mugs, but nobody's kidded themselves that this fellow's the best puncher in the world. He isn't, but he's rated number 18 by the WBC. Although they don't always place so much reliance, really, on the number of ratings. It's who they fought, really, that matters in this business. And he's saying, well, he's used to travelling around the world, Lectori, so this fellow won't suffer from any nerves. He's 29, but he didn't start boxing until he was almost 25. So waiting, of course, now for the entrance of Barry McGuigan. who certainly is one of the greatest attractions that the fight game has had in many, many years. And the supporters have managed to find their way out here. At one time, we looked like fighting on the Isle of Dogs, but that was ruled out and changed here. And there you are, the fight fans have to have a sense of humour. It's not optional either, it's obligatory. So the usual backstage warming up. Boxers just want to do that one little thing to the glove or just get the hand bandages tightened up. A little bit of nerve set in, but the crowd have spotted McGregor now coming back. He's had two fights since he made the inevitable comeback after losing the World Featherweight Championship in the blistering heat of Las Vegas. And now he's up at Super Feather, which is 9 stone 4 pounds against 9 stone at Feather. And he's in at 9.5 for this one. So that's the heaviest that Barry's weighed. And apparently he's very happy with the weight. And there we are, gets a bit of a guard of honour there, doesn't he, with the London Bobby. The trainer Jimmy Tibbs making sure that no too enthusiastic fan slaps him around the shoulders too much. And he does what McGregor calls tunnel vision. Gets the head down, concentrates on the job ahead. Because in this game, you know, nothing's easy. And when you're on the brink of a world championship, sometimes that can turn out to be the one that creates the most nerves. Jim, would that be so?
Yeah, well, Barry's obviously come back. He feels he has something to prove. And the fact that he's been so nervous in his previous two comeback fights really shows how much he wants to please and how much he wants to prove himself again. This, is a good opponent tonight. I don't think he has the power to seriously trouble McGuigan, but he certainly has the talent and the ability to give him a lot of problems and possibly go a lot of rounds. So this should be a little cracker tonight.
Just got a friendly wave there from Tito Lettori. Haven't seen him a lot in America, and he put thumbs up as if to say he was confident his man, well, as Jim Watson, is going to put up at least a good show. And there he is, the boyo himself. Now living in England. But he really does draw the fans in, and he's worked himself up to a fair old sweat by the look of it coming in the ring. And he's got the old Cockney think tank there of trainers, Ernie Fossey with his back there, a former boxer, and Jimmy Tibbs, also boxed and now has his son as a pro. So the loosening up process. The referee is Larry O'Connell. Keeps reminding me he comes from Kent, although he boxed for Fitzroy Lodge underneath the arches at Lambeth. So here's Peter Dennis to introduce them.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event in this Frank Warren promotion from Pickett's Lock Leisure Centre, sponsored by the Daily Star. The World Super Featherweight Title Eliminator Contest of 10 rounds, 3 minutes each round. Introducing and fighting out of the red corner, wearing blue trunks, with a record which includes 29 wins, 1 loss, and 4 draws, the super featherweight champion of Argentina from Jujuy, Argentina. Please welcome Julio Cesar Miranda. And fighting out of the blue corner, wearing green trunks, the most popular boxer in the world today, the former WBA World Featherweight Champion with 31 victories and only 2 losses, the People's Champion, the Clueless Cyclone, Barry McGuigan! At the weigh-in at 11 a.m. today, Miranda scaled 9 stone 4.5 pounds, McGuigan scaled 9 stone 5 pounds. Your timekeeper for this contest, Mr. Bob Edgeworth. Your referee, Mr. Larry O'Connell.
So we might just get a pick up of what the referee's saying here to them. So there is, I know that Miranda doesn't speak any English anyway, and wouldn't make much difference. He's been around enough to know. He hasn't only fought once in Buenos Aires, surprisingly enough. He comes from San Salvador, really, his boxing town. So scheduled for 10 then. And the third on the trot for measuring McGuigan's progress, really. And it looks as though a fight with the IBF champion, the Imperial Boxing Federation, the International Boxing Federation champion, Tony Perez of California, could well be on now for February. It was apparently a lot easier to make negotiations with Lopez people than it may have been for Azuma Nelson of Ghana, the WBC champion, but that match might be inevitable in the end. Stalking early tactics then by McGuigan. He always goes looking for the opponent, doesn't stand off. And he's had a video played to him of Miranda, obviously, in a winning fight. Yeah, a student of the game, McGuigan. He knows about all the opponents, what they do and what they don't do. And it was as much as we know, the blistering heat in the Nevada desert that defeated him, as much as Steve Cruz, without taking any credit away from him. He always tries to find range, Jim, doesn't he, early on, McGuigan? Flicks the left hand out.
Yeah, it feels far more comfortable going forward, backing the opponent up, getting the full power into the punches. I'm surprised Miranda has made a few mistakes already. I expected him to be far more difficult to catch, but he's done a few silly things already. He left his chin really exposed, but McGuigan hasn't warmed up yet and hasn't taken advantage of it. But he's going to have to find a safer place to keep that chin of his. I'm sure Barry will be letting the big punches fly.
Yeah, lock it in a safe deposit, you're right, because when McGuigan nails you, it's particularly at this weight, he's so happy at this, and he looks so, I don't know, say mature. He's always been a strong-looking fighter, but body-looking, he looks the part, Jim, doesn't he?
Yeah, I think the extra 4 or 5 pounds really has given him the confidence. I think he was always dragging down to do featherweight, but very strong, very powerful, as you see here.
So the referee making sure that McGuigan doesn't pull Miranda on. See, the answer is really Argentinians had 29 wins and only one loss, but he hasn't really fought the quality of this opposition. That's been the way that we couldn't really judge him, although he's Argentine champion at 9'4". I always get the feeling that McGuigan likes that first round to go his way, get it over with, get rid of some of the tensions, as we look then at the statistics. And the other defeat on the... We should really talk about so many victories with McGuigan, not losses. The only other one was in his third pro fight against Peter Eubanks down in Brighton. Now, if he can fight like the trainer, that'll be all right there, Jimmy Tibbs, showing him what he wants to do. So Miranda's saying, oh, so this is what fighting former world champions is all about. As I say, you can really ignore the age, because his first amateur fight, he was 20 before he had that. I mean, McGuigan was winning junior championships and Commonwealth gold medals, boxing in the Moscow Olympics.
10 seconds. Second out, round two.
Second round then. And judging from the first, certainly Miranda's got to stay on his bike a bit, isn't he? He's got to move around, because he's getting tagged, particularly with the right hand. I don't blame him to do the old hit and hop it stuff, Jim, but I think McGuigan will cut the ring size down here.
Yeah, well, there were a few signs in the first round that Miranda was going to find real problems coping with McGuigan's pressure. He's been quite accurate with his own left jab now and again. Not a lot of power behind it, hardly any power, as a matter of fact. But when McGuigan really goes to work, he really finds it difficult to get himself out of trouble, and I think that's going to be a big problem as this fight goes along.
Yeah, knows how to take care of himself, bobbing and weaving close in like that, Miranda. But that seemed to be the problem. He doesn't seem to be unloading much power in that leather. It's his problem, not McGuigan's. Well, he looks as though there's orders there, Miranda, from the corner. Keep ducking and diving and moving. Don't stand still, Jim.
Yeah, but McGuigan's such a good pressure fighter. He just keeps the pressure on his opponent all the time. Never gives him a second's time to catch the breath. And he's really getting close to Miranda now.
Well, that old line about they never come back, I think, is going to be disproved yet again. They never come back if they're not good fighters. That's the problem. But this fella McGuigan, when he's in this fiery form like this, he really is a cracker. With a minute to go in the second.
See, I don't think anyone's going to give McGuigan problems unless they have the power to stand and drive McGuigan back. And already we can see Miranda doesn't have that power. So he's in for a rough night. I don't know how long it's going to last, but he's in for a rough night.
Expression on his face there, Miranda saying, I wonder what this is all about. I've never had a guy that comes at me and every punch is a stinger. There's no taps in there with McGuigan. And right above us, we can really hear those punches sinking into the body there. He generates so much excitement, McGuigan, doesn't he? Everything he does, Jim, the whole place is jumping here.
Yep.
Henry Cooper at ringside, Billy Walker. People turn out to see him, no matter where the venue is, it's difficult to get to. And there, as I said, is the old Cockney pair there. The Think Tank boys from London, who now work with McGuigan, and he seems to be very happy. Well, he trains out at Luton quite a lot now. Jim?
Well, McGuigan is always his own most severe critic, and I think he's probably criticising himself at this point for maybe taking too many punches. He has he's been a little bit open himself, and Miranda has been allowed to land a lot more punches than McGuigan usually allows opponents to land. But probably the complete lack of power. McGuigan's quite happy the way things are going. He has far more power than Miranda has, and he's quite happy to trade with him.
And we're into the third round then. And he showed him that punch and then aimed it. And this fellow's only taken one count in his career, apparently. But he's going to get nailed because he won't let go of him now, McGuigan. That's his game, on the hook and stay there. Well, he's not lacking any guts, that's for sure, Miranda. He's taking a good punch on the chin there, and he's trying to fight back, but as Jim Watt said, there's no real no power there. And again, as the long right hand that does the business. There it is, but way off the mark, that one. And the left hooks are not bad either. He's got it all, isn't he, McGuigan, when he's in form like this?
See, as I said earlier, if you don't have the power to trouble McGuigan, then he's just going to roll right over the top of you like a steamroller, because he has so much power himself.
I get the impression that McGuigan just loves it all too, and he's wealthy enough now, company director, not to bother him with all this, but he just loves the fight game, and his ambition is to win, be the first fighter here, Irish or all the British fighters, to win titles at two different weights, world championships. Such extraordinary reach he's got, deceptive, McGuigan. Always says his arms stretch carrying sacks of potatoes around in his younger days, and he probably still does by the look of it.
Minute to go in the third.
Well, full credit to Miranda, because he is really under total pressure, but he's coming back with half-decent punches of his own. The lack of power again is showing itself, but plenty of heart.
Well, I said from the start, Littori wouldn't bring a fighter in who couldn't handle himself fairly well. He's never kidded anybody he brought the best puncher in the world in. Sheer accumulation of punches now is going to take its toll inevitably, but it'll probably be one shot that'll do it with McGuigan. I'm sure it's... He does them in clusters, and then he delivers the one that matters. Has he cut to McGuigan? Well, what do you know about that? McGuigan's cut around the left eye. Jim, how did that happen? It didn't seem as though a punch could have done that.
I didn't see it happening. Miranda's been throwing plenty of leather, but their heads have been very close towards the end of the round, and just as they separated, I saw a little sign of blood on his left eyebrow. It didn't look a severe cut at this stage, but there's no such thing, as you've said, as a good cut.
Well, now that might... could it turn it around? I would think he's going to give it everything in this round, Jim. I mean, he's got to get a bit desperate.
Well, I don't really know that McGuigan can step the pace up any more. I mean, the pace has really been frantic. And here, see, I mean, McGuigan just has not stopped punches from the first bell. That was a good right hand that sent Miranda over. He did very well to get himself back into the fight.
Yeah, that happened right at the start of the third.
Second round, round four.
Well, Ernie Posse's had to get the adrenaline swab working very hard between rounds. The only thing allowed by the Boxing Board of Control, the 1 in 1,000 adrenaline, two staunch cuts. And I would have thought, I mean, not that he's been slacking in any way, McGuigan, but he'll have to try and make every punch count now.
Well, McGuigan's eye has started bleeding again without a punch being thrown, so it's quite possible it's slightly worse than we first thought.
Tell you, Jim, as you say, he's the only one around that doesn't know how bad it is, which is just as well. And he's got very capable corner men, but he's going to need it, McGuigan.
Well, it's slightly alarming that the cut started bleeding again before a blow landed on it. So maybe a little bit deeper than the first start.
Position. Miranda's proved that he's fairly durable anyway. He's taken McGuigan's best punches early on. Nicknamed the squirrel, by the way, the Argentinian, and he's, let's say, been gnawing away a little bit, hasn't he? Flashing that left hand out. Not a lot of power. And he's saying, watch his head there, McGuigan. That's a bit of frustration. You don't often see that, Jim, with him.
No, usually Barry's got such good concentration, he never complains about a thing. I see a little bit of blood on the right-hand side of McGuigan's face. I hope it's just splashed over from the cut. Yeah, I think it's still just the one cut he has. But yeah, that must have been just a little bit of frustration. See, Barry is taking a lot more punches tonight than he normally does. And I know he himself will be criticising himself after. Actually, there's maybe a cut on the other side of his face.
Well, a bit of a slap by McGuigan standards. And I'll tell you what, his face is bloodied there. And he's wiping it away, McGuigan. He's really in trouble here with two cuts now. And it must have come from the Argentinian's head, I would have thought. And obviously worsened by those flicking punches that come in.
Barry's not connecting with full power at the moment, and with a cut over each eye, he really is in serious trouble here. He couldn't raise the pace any higher, but his punches are just don't have that
like Beckham timing. And punching after the bell. Not easy to hear that bell among this din, by the way. And manager Lectori turning there to the referee and saying, watch that. Now, they've really got to work on this now. Clean him up first and then get the adrenaline swab sticks on there. Both eyes, there it is. And this is where the seconds, Jim, really have to earn their corn, don't they? Know their job.
Yeah, well, I think that first cut, as we said, it is a little bit worse than we first anticipated. It started bleeding very early in the round, and then the last thing he needed was another cut on the other side, on the other eye, but that's exactly what's happened. It's difficult to suggest what Barry should do here. He couldn't raise the pace any more than he's been boxing. He's really been at full pelt there from the first bell. He's just going to have to keep doing that and look for that little bit more power, that slightly better timing, just to make his punches count.
Round five.
Well, round five then, and I think the crowd need a minute's rest between rounds to get their breath back, as well as the boxers here. Just, nobody's seen Barry McGuigan bloodied like this before. But what it matters, there's no question that he's won the rounds, Jim, but anyway, that's in the bag.
Yeah, I think the slight problem, his punch is just... Miranda is that little bit more difficult to hit than we first suspected, and McGuigan's punches don't have the real full power because they're not landing just correctly. He's still having trouble getting full power behind his punches. He really is a tricky customer.
Yeah, he's well nicknamed the squirrel, isn't he? A bit crafty. And we got word from the corner there with Ernie Fossey, and he says, we are a bit worried about them. They're both bleeding a bit. And unable to stop them right away. Some fighters, they can stop very quickly. Well, we said when they came in the gym that in this game nothing's easy, especially when the tension's on, when you're just on the brink of getting a world title shot.
Well, we suspected Miranda could give McGuigan a few problems, but we weren't expecting a cut over each eye. I think that's a little bit more problems than we wanted.
See, there's an example there, Jim, with his... just risking his face a bit. He's so determined to get in, McGuigan. But it's some battle, isn't it? They're not exactly battling each other with science at this stage. Minute to go in the fifth. No doubt about it, this American, Argentine, I should say, not American, promoter, Lectori, he's got this conveyor belt that churns out these tough guys, doesn't he?
Yeah, well, the fighter, I think we kept looking at Miranda's record and saying he doesn't have a lot of power, but what we should also have noticed, he hasn't been knocked over. Therefore, he certainly has a good chin. He hasn't boxed in this kind of company before, but he certainly has a good chin, and that's what's giving McGuigan all the problems now. McGuigan is well winning the fight, but he just can't get him over onto that canvas and keep him there. These are better punches now from McGuigan. That little bit snap now is in the punches.
He's left it a bit too late in the round, I think, Jim. And that bell goes now. The referee will have to dive in. Well, he's earned one or two deep breaths, hasn't he, this fella? And the songs from the back of the picket slot centre here. Here we go, here we go. And Barry needs all the encouragement he can get. Jim, the overhead view now in slow motion.
Well, another round in top gear from McGuigan. Just towards the end of the round, he started really getting the shoulder behind the punches. The timing was that little bit more precise, and he finally started rocking Miranda. Good punches, a solid right hand, and he came back with another one shortly after that, which really had Miranda in a bit of trouble. So McGuigan now has maybe slowed him down now enough to really take advantage.
Seconds out, round six.
So coming out for the sixth round of the scheduled 10. Now, having had a little bit more time to work on those cuts, Jim, it looks as though they might have started to staunch the blood there.
Yeah, well, a little bit of blood still just seeping out of his right eyebrow. But they seem to have done a pretty fair job on it. Good right hand from McGuigan. I think the pressure is beginning now to get to Miranda. He's still coping with it well, but it slowed him down that little bit, giving McGuigan a better chance to get power into the punches.
Trading now, both of them with left hands, the more accurate ones coming in from McGuigan. Such a solid jab, that left hand that goes in there, and then he turns him into hooks. But the squirrel is a bit crafty now. He's cut, Jim, isn't he, over the left eye? And yes, he is.
Yep, yeah, I see some blood on there.
So Miranda's cut. They got a bit of a matching set there now. This is some accurate stuff now in the sixth by McGuigan. Obviously the corner men are saying, don't worry about the injuries, we'll take care of those, and they have, and you just get on with the job. Oh, what a good shot. That sort of punch would normally put an opponent down, Jim. This guy's got a bit of granite in the chin.
Yep, these punches are now a lot more solid than in the earlier rounds, but Miranda's still taking the punches. His eyes are still clear. He's beginning to show some signs of fatigue, but his eyes are still clear when these punches land, so he's still coping with them.
He walks onto the right hand. He's walking clockwise into that punch. And he's having a go with his right hand too, to put McGuigan flush there.
Well, there was a little bit more power in that right hand than we expected. It certainly shook Barry slightly. Barry's now moving back for the first time in the fight. That really was a solid right hand punch. Barry's going to have to start pushing Miranda back again.
There was no doubt he was tagged and hurt by that one, McGuigan. No way, that wasn't a bit obvious, as you say, Jim. He backed off immediately, shook his head, and he's dropped his hands as if in frustration. His brother there in the corner, working there. He's a council worker, actually, this fella, from San Salvador. And, hasn't got time to look at the rounds bald lady going past there. Well, it's obviously now that... old crafty Littori there saying, if we can get a win over McGuigan, we're home and dried. And let's have a look at this again now, Jim.
Well, it was a solid right hand with a little bit more power, as I said, than we expected to see from Miranda, and it shook Barry momentarily.
Second out, round seven.
Seventh round, and McGuigan springing out of the stool there. Probably angry that he got caught so flush of the chin. Well, you can't miss every punch in this game. You've got to be somebody to be able to do that, to fight the way he does. Really changed tactics, Jim McGuigan. He's doing all that's asked of him. It's just maybe been only had two fights and a comeback. He's just still a bit rusty in defence.
Yeah, well, when your style is based on all-out total aggression and pressure, then you have to expect to take a few punches. I will say McGuigan has taken more tonight than he would like himself. He has really been taking a little bit too many, but no power so far, so he's been quite happy to do that and keep his own pressure going. McGuigan shouldn't change his act. He has to keep doing what he's doing and just hope eventually he's going to break this man down. He's doing everything right. The punches are good. The pressure's good. He's just going to have to wait until both of these things begin to take effect.
Flush on the chin. He's caught him with those right hands and he's still standing up. And taken that one brief knockdown at the start of the third, Miranda. Minute to go in the seventh. And we said in the previous round, Jim, that Miranda was showing a little bit of signs of tiredness, but surprisingly, he takes the shots and then comes back again. You think he's going over and he doesn't.
Even here he is, he's trying actually to push McGuigan back now. A little surprised. Some of these punches have been bang on the chin, but his face doesn't change expression. No change, no panic in the eyes. He just takes the punch and comes right back at McGuigan again. A real tough little fighter.
He's got a steely heart and a chin to match. Well, just keeping a bit of order there.
That was probably the best right hand of the fight so far, and Miranda's still standing there looking at him, but that was a corker.
He's running out of time in the round. Oh, yes. And if it goes down, he'll ignore the bell if it goes and continue counting. But as he's on his feet, the referee can lead him back to the corner. See, the referee didn't hear the bell. There, he did the right thing, Larry O'Connell. He was going to start the count, but so long as he's regained his feet, but they can't be hauled back to the corner. That used to happen years ago. That's now been barred in boxing. So at the end of that round, then, now that looks as though, Jim, that McGuigan was on the way to a victory there. Another half minute earlier might have made it. There it is.
Yeah, well, I think he finally got him out of there. I think the real damage was done in the right hand just a bit, 10 or 12 seconds before that. He caught Miranda with a corker of a punch, which didn't send him over. But that one, he obviously couldn't take another one. That was a cracking punch, and I think the fight would have been over with a little bit more time there.
So, as I say, the seconds have done their job well there. The first aid, anyway, they managed to keep that going. And it looks like, can he do it in the eighth round now, McGuigan? He's still got to get control, Jim. He mustn't walk in, hang the chin out, McGuigan.
Yeah, well, he'll still do exactly as he's been doing, push Miranda back and keep throwing punches, look for the openings. Maybe McGuigan's actually picking his punches a little bit better now. He's placing them on the target, and that right hand that put Miranda over really was a beauty.
Yes, he just stepped that few inches nearer when he unloaded that punch. Strange enough, the referee sprung there as if he thought Miranda was going down. And the gun shield goes flying out. It's going to be stopped, I think. Any second, somebody's thrown something in the ring there. It looks like the Argentinian's thrown a towel in. And it's all over in the eighth round. Total confusion was going on there. Jim, what was that? Thrown in the ring, I think it was your brother threw the ice pack in the ring, actually, of all things. Yeah, that's not permitted. Well, what a finish from McGuigan. He had one or two shaky moments there, I know he'll admit that. But at the end, that was the McGuigan that we saw in the heyday, the World Champions Day. And, well, let's hope that he can go on from there, Jim.
Well, McGuigan's previous two comeback fights, he's had things pretty much his own way. Nobody had any power to trouble him. But he had to grit his teeth a little bit more tonight. He had the troubles of a cut over both eyes. A real stubborn opponent to come back with a little bit of power of his own. McGuigan really had to show world class tonight, and thankfully shown that world class. I would say now he's definitely ready to go back for that world title that he wants.
12 seconds of round eight.
And as the time's being announced in that round, this is when it all happened. That's where the gum shield came flying out. And really, I can't shout above the MC at the moment. And there you see the ice pack came flying in. And this fella's head and spirit was being jointly bludgeoned at that time, and the old defence became a blown safe, really, as McGuigan unloaded the best punches of the fight. Jim?
Yeah, well, Miranda was under total pressure right from the first bell. He coped with it wonderfully well, but eventually it had to give. It gave in the previous round. He just had very little more to offer. And McGuigan, as usual, once he sees his chance, McGuigan only needs one chance, took that chance, started raining the punches in. The referee maybe could have moved in slightly quicker. But here he goes now, and they get Miranda out of there.
Well, as usual, there's the usual carnival here. And while we're waiting now to have word with McGuigan, we'll take a quick break.
Welcome back to Pickett's Lock, the centre humming with excitement after an epic battle won by Barry McGuigan. The fight stopped in the eighth round, and Barry's in the ring now with Jim Rosenthal.
Barry, many congratulations indeed. Was that a much tougher fight than you expected?
I know. I think I predicted a couple of weeks ago that this would be a distance fight. This guy's not hard to hit, or not easy to hit. He's very difficult to hit. He was, to put it in a nutshell, he was a wee bit more difficult than I'd anticipated. He was harder to hit with the combination punches. He moved his head very well, and he didn't expose his body. He kept his hands tucked in, so he was bending right over, and he was dangerous with the head. He banged me on both sides.
Now, were those cuts caused by his head, you feel?
Yes, on both occasions. I'm not saying they were deliberate, but he banged me with his head on both occasions, and I think I signaled to the referee that he did. He was using his head, but
you're always, Barry, your severest critic, aren't you? Your own severest critic. Were you disappointed you didn't stop him when you got him down in the third?
I wasn't, no. I wanted to slow down and put my punches together. I wasn't throwing them in combinations. I was trying to force my way a wee bit too much at the beginning. And then, of course, later on, I realised that I had to throw more clusters of punches. You know, throw them in bunches. Jimmy was saying to me, throw them in bunches. Don't stop throwing them. Just don't throw one or two. Throw three, four, five, and keep stabbing that jab out, and you'll eventually nail him with the right hand.
Has the intensity and the closeness of this fight made you change your mind at all about the fact that you're going to be world champion once again?
No, I don't believe that at all. I think this guy was unbeaten. He hadn't been beaten before. He'd never been down before, so, I mean, I put him down twice. And really, I should have had him a bit earlier than this, but I'm not disappointed. On the whole, it was a good performance. It was an entertaining fight for you, I think, Jim. And, I like to give the crowd value for money. But I put on a good performance. Could have stopped him a bit earlier. My timing was slightly off. But he was a very cagey customer, unbeaten, and he came here to win. I told you all that.
He certainly did. Let's just take a look down at the end of the fight, Barry, if you look at our monitor down here. And it was a terrific climax to the fight, and we were all wondering when he was going to go, and these were the moments.
Yes, I tried to hit him a long left hook here in the right hand. And then, bang, that was the first left hook.
Out went the gum shield.
I threw him a right hand. I didn't. I just sort of slid off with that, and I hit him better with the second one. And he was on his way out at that stage. You know, a wee bit, you see the way he didn't expose his body. He left it very difficult for me to hit him. But, haven't seen it. I'll sit and watch the fight again, but I think it was a reasonably good performance, no doubt.
Now, there might be just a little bit of disagreement between yourself and Frank Warren. You're saying you're going to have a good Christmas, and you're not too worried about a world title fight until, what, March or April, is that right?
I've worked hard for this fight, and, I've been in training since August, the beginning of August. And, the fight has been postponed a number of times, and there's been several hiccups. But because of that, I've obviously a lot of commercial commitments to fill in. And I like to enjoy me Christmas, so I would imagine I'll be ready for fighting for a world title. We'll sit down with Frank and discuss it, but I would imagine around March sometime.
Go on then, Frank.
Well, he's the fella getting in the ring, not me. So as soon as he's ready to get in, we'll go for it.
So the next time he'll be in the ring, it will be for a world title.
Oh, it's got to be now, hasn't it? I mean, I think he needed this tonight. He needed this type of fight. The fellow was a very cagey customer. It took a long time before he got to him. But finally, when he got there, yeah, it'll happen. The next one's got to be a world title fight, and that's what he's going for. And that's what I know, what Barry wants.
Barry, once again, from all of us at ringside, you gave us great entertainment and millions of others around the country as well. Bloodied, but not beaten. Well done.
No, I think I could do it again. You know, as I say, I wasn't tired. I threw a lot of punches, forced to fight all the way. And you know, I feel like I'll go seven more rounds, so still there, boy, still there.
I think you can relax. We'll forget the seven rounds for now. Thanks for joining us, Barry.
In midweek sports special last week, you might have seen that impressive and summary performance from the former British and European light middleweight champion, Chris Pye. You may have seen him absolutely demolish Eddie Hall. Well, tonight he was fighting again just 8 days later. This time he was up against another American, Knox Brown. Now, we're going to join it in round two. Our commentators again are Jim and Reg.
Oh, yes, he's picking him off with absolute ease now, and he's a brave fella, this, but I'm afraid he's going to need more than heart here.
Yeah, Pye is just punching right through his defence now. He's stopped looking for openings. He's just punching right through the defence, and I'm thinking Brown's going to have to come up with something else. What he's trying here is not working. He's just shipping punishment.
Well, Larry O'Connell's a star grade referee, does world championships, so I shouldn't think he'd... Yes, there it is, it's all over. And stop boxing, he's quite right. He tried to give Brown a little bit of breathing space if he could to try and recover from that, but, well, Chris Pye looked as though he was in unstoppable form. They're arguing a bit in the corner. He's a game guy. He probably says, I've had tougher fights than that, and the referee let me go on. But happy-go-lucky fella, but that's it. At 30 years old, maybe he should be forgetting about it now, and the... We're going to see a lot more, I think, of Chris Pye, and he and Gary Stretch for the championship is one that we can look forward to.